While the struggle of Afrikaners to improve their lot and recapture their dignity was directed against the English speakers above them, simultaneously, they, together with English speakers, struggled to control the conquered peoples below. The two white peoples cooperated to maintain the conquest. The conquered had lost half their former land, their means of livelihood. Much of what was left was overcrowded and eroded. Overcrowded with refugees from many disasters. But they were not left alone in their misery. Those who had taken their pastures and gardens now came to take their men for labor. It is an ancient story. Mass poverty was something new to African mixed farmers. They had had the experience of natural disasters and wars amongst themselves. There had been poor men in their societies, but these were individuals. The poverty being experienced by the people in the lands called native reserves was a poverty that broke up families. Men were made to live apart from their wives and children. No mixed farmer before the conquest could have imagined this. Life in a stinking barrack or corrugated metal shack for months on end. The man in the single-sex barrack was fed. His labor counted. But his wife and children back home were less fortunate when the price of maize at the trading store was raised. She had no idea why this was done. She didn't know that the Maize Industry Control Board had lowered the price of maize sold to white stock feeders as feed for their cattle and had decided to set a higher price for human consumers to compensate for the loss on the cheap feed. It made her and others poorer. Some neighbors were admitted into a Victoria Hospital, a missionary hospital in the Cape Province, dying from starvation. This wasn't the intention of the control board. The intention was focused on the men, to take them far away to work. Some men wanted to leave to experience a world they had never seen, but these were not enough. Those who didn't want to leave their families were induced to leave by a special tax, which raised the family's cost of living. The choice then became being arrested by the district commissioner's men, or paying in cash, or promising to pay in cash by signing up at the district commissioner's office for work on a distant white farm or business, or signing up for a stint in the mines. Some mixed farmers collectively resisted the tax and the hardship and family separation it brought, but to no avail. After competing initially for African labor, mine owners had agreed not to compete in the wage offered, followed by setting up a joint recruiting organization designed to offer a single low cash wage. At this wage, the miner could not pay the cost of having his family living nearby. Cheap labor thus obtained was then channeled to the end users by a pass system. The pass had to be in the bearer's possession at all times. On it was recorded the bearer's vital information, including ethnicity, tax status, employer, or authorized destination. Some tried their luck avoiding the lowest paid farm and mine work. They made their way to the towns looking for opportunity. Some accepted pay at less than it would have cost this man's employer to put up a pole. Seeking out those without pass authorization was one of the principal tasks of the police. As we have seen, getting caught without a pass or with a passbook infraction might wind up with the arrested man laboring on a white farm after all. But this time, without any cash payment. Many Africans had pass authorization to remain in towns indefinitely. These were the men who had built the towns and had been there, often with families, from the beginning. The number of permanent residents, legal and illegal, kept increasing. Unlike the mine managements, urban employers who needed a stabilized labor force which didn't require periodic retraining paid wages sufficient to permit family life near the job site. But all categories of black labor were kept cheap by prohibiting Africans from forming unions or going on strike. To the first two components of the cheap labor system, the special tax payable in cash, passed laws to channel the labor to users, this was the third. The pressure on the defeated during the decades following their conquest came from the entire Western world. In the background is the American General Motors factory in Port Elizabeth, mid-century. In the foreground are homes of workers. Adding to the stress on the defeated, produced by tax, pass, and anti-strike laws, which separated parents and depressed incomes, were the laws that raised the price of essentials. Tariff laws, marketing laws, laws requiring that certain jobs be reserved for expensive white labor. These were laws designed to assist particular sections of the voting population. Inexorably, pressure on the central institution of the former mixed farmers, the family, built up. The family then began to break. This boy, unable to keep food down in the Transkei in the 1970s, had passed malnourishment's point of no return when the body's machinery for protein synthesis, itself made of protein, has been degraded, and death cannot be prevented by giving food or protein. Some fathers or brothers did not return to their families. They tried to forget what was happening to their lives and to the lives of those they loved back home. They found places to drink. Among the places to drink were municipal beer halls run as revenue enhancers by the white municipalities. These were monopolies. By law, no one else could sell intoxication. Many African women did not submit to this law. They opened shebeens where stronger drink than the municipal beer was available, and other drugs. All in the woman organizer's house, a smaller space than a municipal beer hall. Often there were women there, women of all ages, most, like the men, without any prospects. A laborer on his day off might meet in a township an unmarried woman with children on her day off. 6 days in the week, she slept in a backyard room of a white residence for which she was a housekeeper or nanny. Her children had to care for themselves. Life took its course. Illegitimate births were being officially registered in the 1950s at rates of up to 70%. In townships around Johannesburg, Durban, and Bloemfontein. A white woman who studied the problem wrote, "Immorality among urban Africans has become so prevalent that unless the traditional integrity of family life is regained, the African people are in danger of moral collapse. Fatherless youths grouped together. They became impossible to control. They boarded trains packed with black urban workers returning with their Friday pay. As the jam of standing passengers left the train, one or more would fall to the floor, dead from a knife wound, and with pockets empty. The lesson of Ubuntu, of humanity, the keystone of the traditional mixed farmers education, was not being taught in the shanty towns surrounding the cities. By mid-century, murders and rapes were occurring in South Africa at a rate more than double that of the United States and 20 times greater than in Nigeria. The conquerors also became more afraid. What would happen to them should the conquest become undone? This fear was greatest among Afrikaners. Most were without the skills and income of the English speakers. They would be the first to be dispensed with. In 1938, as the centenary of the Battle of Blood River approached, wagons from all over the country converged at the site where the foundation stone of the Voortrekker Monument was to be laid. Dr. D.F. Malan, a minister of the Dutch Reformed Church and 10 years later Prime Minister of South Africa, addressed the large crowd, declaring that the voortrekkers had had the protection of a river and ramparts. Now, 1938, Afrikaners stood without the protection of a river and ramparts, defenseless before the English-speaking employer who wanted only cheap black labor, and, as he put it, defenseless on the open plains of economic equality. The Voortrekker Monument, South Africa's largest monument, was dedicated in Pretoria, the capital, before 175,000 people on the anniversary of the Battle of Blood River, the single day when the shaft of sunlight from a slit in the roof passes directly over the dedication inscription. We for you, South Africa. A second Voortrekker monument was erected in the Orange Free State in 1968, 26 years before power in South Africa was turned over to an African leader. Afrikaners fortified themselves against their fear by memorials recalling that their God was with them. In many street names throughout South Africa, and in this statue, Sarel Selier, one of the Voortrekker leaders, was remembered for leading the Voortrekkers in a covenant with God before the Battle of Blood River. They vowed then that if God would protect them and deliver the enemy into their hands, they would build a church, and that the day of their victory would be commemorated as if it were the Sabbath by them and their descendants. The Church of the Vow was built, and as I have mentioned, December 16th, the day of the Covenant and of the Battle of Blood River, became the country's national holiday, when all places of public entertainment and sport were to be closed by law, as on a Sunday. Another way the conquerors dealt with the unexpected aftermaths of conquest was to try not to think about them. Human-to-human contact with the conquered was limited between adults, although it was almost the rule between white children and black and colored caregivers. Outside of contact at work, the conquered were kept in the cities in guarded barracks, or separate townships outside the cities. Townships with hardly any shops of their own, of any kind. They were all but complete dependencies of the conqueror's economy. The conquered traveled to and from the townships and work in separate buses, or sections of buses. Some were made to live in places so far from their work that much of their lives were spent traveling, with only a few hours sleep at home. For some, work and travel consumed more than 16 hours a day. On farms, conquerors and conquered lived much closer. Here, white farmers knew how and on what their servants and laborers lived. In towns or farms, the conquerors in South Africa, as other conquerors have done, tried to put the conquered and their problems as much at a distance as possible, and not to see them or relate to them as people. But this was not completely possible. To spread Christianity was an avowed aim, but this could not be done without white missionaries establishing relationships with individuals among the conquered on a human-to-human level. To enable the Bible to be read by blacks and browns meant that the conqueror's original monopoly of literacy had to be relinquished. Not only that, mission schools, if they were to attract potential converts, had to offer a much broader transfer of culture, including secular knowledge and skills. This began to affect the stability of the conquest. We see this in the formation in 1912 of the South African Native National Congress. This was the world's first black political organization, later renamed the African National Congress, or ANC, which became South Africa's ruling party in 1994. John Dube, the founding president of the new organization, here seated in the center, was, as were other founding members, mission-educated. As a member of a prosperous royal family, he was also able to further his education, in his case, at Oberlin College in Ohio. 1912, the ANC's founding year, was only 2 years after the formation of the Union of South Africa by the two formerly warring white peoples. Their motto, out of unity, strength. Whites believed that while they themselves must henceforth cooperate as a single racial group, the peoples they had conquered must remain attached to their separate tribal identities. Official policy was geared to this, but the transfer of literacy was undermining it. From the start, the ANC campaigned against tribalism. As Zulus, Khoisans, Pedi, Sotho, Tswana, as attached to a past that was gone forever, black peoples would remain defeated, each a weak and exploited minority. But as bearers of a new identity, that is, as Africans, they constituted the country's majority, and as such, they would not remain defeated. The attraction of cheap labor itself also worked to subvert white domination. As the economy expanded and manufacturing and services began to outpace agriculture and mining, demand proliferated for categories of cheap labor that were also literate in rising degrees of literacy. The delivery man who could read street signs and addresses. The teacher who might have taught the delivery man, paid at a lower rate than a white teacher, more educated than her students, and requiring training from persons even more educated than herself. The developing economy needed more skilled workers than whites could supply. Even black and brown professional workers were needed for tasks for which whites would have charged more than the economy could afford. These are students at a segregated government-financed medical school opened in 1947, training to become doctors. Disease could not be confined to the impoverished black townships that surrounded the cities. Black professionals in fields other than medicine followed a variety of pathways to higher education. Cyril Ramaphosa, future leader of the Black Mine Workers Union, studied at a government-established tribal university until he was expelled. Nelson Mandela obtained a law degree by correspondence from the University of South Africa. The transfer of literacy produced black journalists, newspapers directed at black readers, chauffeurs on the street, miners in their barracks. Religious proselytizing and the demand by whites for literate classes of cheap labor had launched a process that, by the end of the Second World War, was swelling the ranks of the African National Congress. By mid-century, the ANC was no longer, as it had once been, a handful of educated men appealing vainly for redress through letters addressed to government ministers, but a mass organization capable of mobilizing thousands to defy racial laws and to support boycotts and strikes. The ANC was also beginning to act in concert with organizations that were mobilizing the two other legally defined subordinated peoples, the Coloureds, discussed in South Africa Part 1, and the Indians. Tens of thousands of Indians had been brought to Britain's Natal colony during the 19th century as indentured laborers to work the province's sugarcane plantations and coal mines. Most remained in South Africa after their periods of indenture ended, preserving much of their original cultures, although English gradually replaced the ancestral languages. They were joined there by Hindu and Muslim traders who paid their own passage from India. Many of these men over the centuries built successful businesses. But poverty remained the lot of most Indians, and racial discrimination the lot of all. The laws of one of the provinces prohibited their entry. Those of another had forbidden them from walking on pavements. In 1955, after a defiance campaign during which thousands of volunteers were arrested for nonviolent contravention of racially based laws, the ANC convened the Congress of the People, bringing together more than 3,000 delegates in a field outside Johannesburg, including representatives of colored and Indian organizations, and some whites. Police broke up the meeting, but not before a Freedom Charter was adopted. This is part of the Freedom Charter, as here etched into the wall of a waiting cell in the Justice Building in Pretoria. It became the basic policy statement of the ANC and its colored Indian and white allies. For all but a handful of whites, the goals of the Freedom Charter portended a future that was unimaginable, and as far as they were concerned, could and would never be achieved. However, some white academics and churchmen began to meet and to ask whether a policy of pure repression was sustainable. Was there perhaps not a third way forward, one that would result neither in majority rule nor white domination? They called this possible third way apartheid, or separate development. It concerned them that the economy was becoming inextricably dependent not only on unskilled, but also on skilled black labor. Blacks were organizing not as members of tribes, but on a racial basis, as whites had done. And blacks' numerical preponderance over whites was climbing. 3-1 at mid-century, nearly 8-1 expected by end of century. They concluded that if whites were to have any future in South Africa, apartheid or separate development would have to mean complete racial separation, resulting in blacks and whites living in separate parts of the country, with neither race ruling nor posing a threat to the other. The current dispensation in a single economy and single political system, where the white's floor was the black's ceiling, would have to go. Whites would have to do all of their own work. Only by complete racial separation could whites expect to have a future in South Africa. But for white farmers, mine and factory owners, and small businessmen, whose actual livelihoods were wholly dependent on African labor, unlike professors and ministers, whose employment of cheap labor was limited to household servants, complete racial separation was unthinkable. This didn't mean that nothing needed to be done to alter the direction of the changes that were occurring. But what? In 1950, the government appointed F.R. Tomlinson, a professor of agricultural economics, to lead a commission to study the options. 5 years later, its massive report, consisting of 17 volumes, was issued to the government and to the public. If the current course of economic integration continued unimpeded, the commission warned, full equality, including the vote, could not be withheld from blacks indefinitely. Full equality would be followed by intermarriage. Eventually, the white race would be absorbed in a new biological entity. Only ultimate complete separation between white and black could preserve the white race in South Africa. The magnitude of the task required to bring complete racial separation about is indicated by this map. The territories colored gray are not part of South Africa. The area in white represents the more than 87% of the country to which whites held title. It was sometimes referred to as White South Africa, although inhabited at the time of the study by twice as many blacks as whites. Coloreds and Indians also inhabited so-called white South Africa, though these peoples numbered less than whites and were not considered by whites to be a major problem. The reserves, those parts of South Africa left in tribal occupation after their conquest, are the colored-in areas on this map. The flow of work seekers from these areas into so-called white South Africa would have to be stopped and reversed. The reserves were currently in no shape to accommodate the vast increase in population envisaged by halting immigration from them and initiating immigration into them. They were already overcrowded and eroded, bare of industries, importers of food, exporters of men without whose labor in white South Africa, their remaining population consisting largely of destitute women and small children and old men, would be doomed. First, half the population of the reserves would have to be moved off the land in order to enable those families remaining on the land to obtain at least a subsistence living without having to export their adult males to seek work in white South Africa. The traditional communal land tenure system, under which plots were distributed by chiefs on the basis of need to both efficient and inefficient users, would have to be replaced by a system of freehold tenure. This would undermine the power of the chiefs and would end up with land in the hands of actual owners who would make a go of it or could sell to those who could. But even this reform would be ineffective without the government undertaking a simultaneous and expensive program to stabilize and reclaim the reserve lands from erosion. Expert witnesses told the commission that the soils would not survive another 10 years of inaction. To accommodate those drawn off the land as a result of agricultural reorganization in the reserves, together with the millions who would be leaving white South Africa and the millions anticipated through future population growth, more than 100 new towns would have to be established in the reserves, quote, without delay, unquote, along with the provision of power, water, transport, communication, and also starting from scratch, 50,000 new employment opportunities in industry and commerce to be added each year. None of this could take place without ending the ban on private white investment in the reserves, nor without increasing government expenditures in the form of outright grants, or in the case of housing, monies recoverable through rent payments. If fully undertaken, the Thomason Commission projected, white farmers and all other employers in white South Africa would lose none of their black labor force. Indeed, the black population would still exceed the white population in white South Africa in the year 2000, though by a smaller preponderance than if the recommendations were not implemented. Economists later pointed out serious flaws in the plan's details, such as that the commission was proposing the creation of an urban industrial complex in the reserves equal in population magnitude to the existing one in South Africa as a whole that had taken over 50 years to develop, with a spending program that was less than the investments made in 1 year by a single South African insurance company. Nevertheless, the Thomason Report was the first and only official attempt to provide the announced policy of separate development with detailed targets and expenditure figures. The development program for the reserves, the report concluded, should be implemented, quote, in the spirit of an act of faith, or the inevitable consequences of the integration of the Bantu and European population groups into a common society must be endured. The government accepted the commission's goal to move into the reserves that part of white South Africa's black population that was surplus to the labor needs of white employers, but it rejected the recommendations of the commission that development of the reserve should be the way to accomplish this. To replace the tribal land tenure system that was administered by chiefs with freehold tenure as means towards a more sustainable agriculture was out of the question, as this, quote, would undermine the whole tribal structure, unquote. The African National Congress was trying to eliminate tribal identities and the influence of government-appointed and paid chiefs. What sense would it make for the government itself to help do the work of the ANC? Similarly, the Commission's call to industrialize the reserves through large public expenditures and by giving a green light to white capital investment there made no security sense to the government and was rejected. Not only would the reserve population be untrammeled by a color bar, but with large-scale public and private investment, they would develop in every direction and grow stronger. How long would it be before they demanded an end to the harsh conditions imposed on their relatives and friends in white South Africa? For the government, separate development meant, therefore, that any development occurring in the reserves would have to be financed by their inhabitants. In effect, therefore, development could not and would not occur. A vast shifting of people into these areas would proceed, but with minimal provision for their sustenance. The poverty of the reserve populations would guarantee that their respective governments would remain completely dependent on and subject to the control of the government in Pretoria. Pretoria would finance the accoutrements of self-government, including buildings, the salaries of legislators and executives. Apartheid, or separate development, operating in this way, appeared to strengthen white security. Some opposition there might be, but nothing effective. At the time the Thomason Commission reported to the government in 1956, all of Africa south of the Sahara, except for Liberia and Ethiopia, was divided into white-ruled colonies where racial segregation and racial inequality was entrenched, as it was throughout the United States. No one knew that a mere 20 years remained before white supremacy would enter its final crisis in South Africa. So, apartheid proceeded. An estimated 3.5 million people were deported into the reserves. These were persons deemed, quote, no longer fit for work or superfluous to the labor market, unquote. After removing furniture, window frames, roofing, and whatever else might be salvaged for loading onto government trucks, their homes were demolished, and the deportees transported to a reserve. This was either where they had been raised or, in official language, quote, the territory of the national unit where they fit ethnically, unquote, whether or not they had ever lived there. Black sharecroppers and black farmers who rented land from white farmers but were not employees were rounded up. Also rounded up were black farmers whose legal title to the land they farmed dated to a time before it became illegal for blacks to purchase land in white South Africa. Their holdings constituted so-called black spots on the map of white South Africa and needed to be cleared up. Forced removals cost some white farmers rental income and crop shares, but there were benefits. One was the chance to rent out their trucks to the government for use in the deportations. Another, when deportees were told that they couldn't bring their cattle along, was the opportunity to acquire their animals at for sale prices and to graze them on the vacated lands. In only 10 years, the population of the reserves increased by almost 70%. But how to keep the deported people in place? Providing them with rental units was not enough. Without jobs, the displaced in these so-called Bantu homelands would return to white South Africa, however strenuously the police tried to prevent this. The police were already preoccupied, arresting more than 300,000 black people annually on pass offenses. In one 12-month period, more than 479,000 Africans were prosecuted for offenses against the pass laws. But the government thought it had a solution to the constant backflow from the reserves and the resultant strain on the police and the courts. The Tomlinson report had called for establishing industries within the reserves. We have seen that government rejected this. In its place, white investors would be encouraged by subsidies and other incentives to establish border industries, that is, industries located around the perimeter of white South Africa itself, within white territory, but near the border of a reserve. This would have two major advantages. It would bring about industrial decentralization, thereby inhibiting the dangerous concentration of the black workforce in just four existing complexes. The second benefit would be that jobs would be created that would help to hold the reserve populations in place, but without the dangers inherent in locating the factories and jobs in the Bantu homelands themselves. Homelands that might not forever remain under white control. Mornings, the workforce would cross the border into white South Africa. Evenings, it would return to the homeland. Should the workers demand to vote, the policy of separate development guaranteed their right to vote in their homeland. Basic housing units could be constructed inside the reserves, with the costs recoverable through rent payments and other service charges. Workers would have the prospect of living as family units, a factor in labor stabilization that would help to attract investors. In some instances, the border industry was established a 2.5 hours bus journey each way from the reserve to which its workforce had been relocated. The government did not expect its border industry program to turn out to be bad news. To attract investments to peripheral areas which lacked the infrastructure possessed by the country's major industrial complexes, special inducements had to be given. Most importantly, the lifting of the minimum wage requirements that obtained in the older industrial areas. This the government was prepared to do, but not for the consequence. Low-wage border factories with labor costs a third or less of those in the cities began turning out products at prices undercutting those of similar products produced in the cities and causing substantial job losses there, including the jobs of white workers. White workers were the government's constituents. In 1959, just 3 years after the parliamentary debate on the Tomlinson Report, a deputation of white trade unionists met with the then Minister of Labor to request that the government introduce wage controls in border industries to prevent unfair competition. The minister recorded their representations on a dictaphone in order, he explained, to give his cabinet colleagues a first-hand impression of the case. Clearly, he didn't want the bad news to come out of his own mouth. The special benefits giving border industries a competitive advantage had to be withdrawn, leaving racial deportations to proceed without significant job creation at the end of the line. Trucks continued to offload deportees in the middle of nowhere, but people unable to scratch out an existence could not be held in place, so the flow in the opposite direction also continued. To stem this flow, the government ordered the destruction of the shanty towns ringing the cities. Time and again, people's shelters were demolished, only to be put up by the residents again and again. Demolitions sharpened the problem of surviving each day, but returning to a reserve would make this problem sharper still. At least in a city, there were people with money to spend. Despite the deportation from the white-owned countryside of black renters, sharecroppers, and farm owners, nevertheless, the white-owned countryside was becoming increasingly black. According to the South African police, not a single white person was to be found on thousands of farms, as ever more of them were occupied exclusively by black laboring families working for absentee owners. Simultaneously, the border industry's policy was failing. And with its failure, the attempt to prevent the further growth and concentration of the black labor force in the existing four major industrial complexes: the Southern Transvaal, including Johannesburg, Cape Town, Port Elizabeth, and Durban. Over the vast countryside and in the villages, towns, and cities, white South Africa was becoming ever more black. For most of the white public, racial integration in a unitary society was unacceptable. But this would be the outcome. The government's Tomlinson Commission warned of continuing to couple economic integration of the races with racial repression. This middle way, it termed the existing policy, was unsustainable. There was but one alternative. But for the 3 million people who ruled the country, complete racial separation equally was unacceptable.